All for joining us online. We are excited to have you guys join us here this morning. You know, as I was contemplating on what to speak on, and when the pastor was gone and he asked me, I didn't know exactly what to speak on, and God placed upon my heart to speak about the holiness of God, you know, and it was a reminder as I was studying and preparing for this message of the enormity of who God is. And so, I mean, I've taken him for granted. You know, I've definitely not given him the reverence and the attention that he deserves. And I think it's something that all of us at one time or another in our relationship with God encounter, this familiarity that we have, this perception that we have of God. And because of that familiarity, we've waned from the awesomeness of who God is in our lives, and kind of it's changed from when we first encountered him, when we first met him, when we first gained that relationship with him. We no longer have that awe and wonder and splendor of the Lord that we once had. And so hopefully and prayerfully this morning, as I've been reunited with and reminded of the true holiness of God, after this morning's message, you will too. Would you bow your heads and pray with me this morning? Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord God, for this wonderful morning that you prepared for us, Lord God. With all the things that are swirling around in the world, gosh, we are wondering, gosh, what is going to happen? Lord, but we trust in you, the sovereign God. Help us to understand, Lord, the true magnitude of the subject that we're going to be speaking this morning about your holy character. We know that we are truly treading on holy ground here. And if it wasn't for your abounding grace, none of us would be here this morning. And so we beg of you that you would grant us a double portion of your grace and mercy today as we seek to understand these things that are so important to the understanding of truly who you are and how holy you are. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Like I said, we'll be talking this morning about the holiness of God. And there's a sermon by the great Tony Evans in which he uses the illustration involving dishes to make sense of the term holy. In his home, and in most homes, really, there are two types of dishes. There are the regular dishes, the ones that you corner off with French fries and squirt a little ketchup on. Now, those dishes are the ones that contain the average meal on the normal days for your ordinary and unimpressive breakfasts, lunches, and dinners. Some of them are chipped and maybe even cracked. And if they are, and you don't whine over their disposal because they were never made to be any special in any way. Then there are all those other dishes, right? These dishes don't even see the light of day until the tall green tree with multicolored lights flicker them onto the dining table. Something significant has to happen under the roof to make their use a necessity. When all is normal again, the candles have been blown out, the wrapping paper has been scattered and collected, the guests have finally gotten up from the table, these dishes, after being cleaned, aren't placed in the cabinets with the French fry and ketchup plates. Those are too typical and regular for their company. They're placed in an entirely different cabinet that may be in an entirely different room, separated from everything unlike them because there is nothing in the house like them. They are set apart, unique, different, other, distinct, cut off from what's considered common. To put it metaphorically, these dishes are holy. Now, this illustration from Tony Evans, obviously, I mean, he kind of gives us an idea of what holiness is, but it's a far cry from the holiness of God, amen? Because God is much more holy than a bunch of dishes. But the words that Tony Evans uses to describe the holiness of these dishes is right on. He said, set apart, unique, different, other, distinct, cut off from what's considered common. Now, I'm going to give you an Old Testament story that will help us to introduce to us a king and a prophet to help us to describe the holiness of God. But before I do that, I want to kind of segue into our story by asking you kind of an off-the-wall question, but we're going to tie it all together. Do you know how many U.S. presidents have been assassinated? Anybody know? Any guess? Two? Three? There's four. Four presidents have been assassinated. I think you all know of two of them, like Michael was holding his fingers up. Who was the first one? Lincoln. Exactly. Abraham Lincoln, assassinated by John Wilkes Booth in 1865. Shot him in the back of the head. Second, James Garfield. He was our 20th president. He was, in 1881, less than 4 months after taking office, President Garfield was shot twice in the back by Charles Guiteau at a railroad station in Washington, D.C. Third victim, William McKinley, right? He was our 25th president. President McKinley, in 1901, was shot twice by Leon Sokols while attending a musical event in Buffalo, New York. And then lastly, and most recently, not too recently, but our 35th president, Kennedy, right? John F. Kennedy, in Dallas, Texas, on November 22nd, 1963, almost a month to the day before I was born, actually. That's how old I am. In his presidential motorcade, while riding alongside his wife, and I believe the governor and his wife at the particular time, was shot by former Marine Lee Harvey Oswald. I mean, he was sniped from a six-story building and gave President Kennedy a perfect headshot. Now, that's still under investigation. There's still a bunch of uncertainty about that. They're saying that maybe he wasn't even the one that pulled the trigger. Some say that he wasn't just the shooter that was by himself. He was involved in the mob, but it's still an unsolved mystery today. But what I'm getting at with all of this is anytime a president or an executive leader or a king or prime minister of a nation gets tragically removed from office, there will be a serious trauma for that nation. Well, that was true in Israel as well as the United States, because in the 8th century, a king came to the throne in Jerusalem at the tender age of 16 years old, and he reigned in Jerusalem for over 50 years. Imagine somebody ruling for over half a century. I mean, can you imagine having a single president in office for over 50 years? I think he'd end up on that assassinations list, right? But this king who reigned in Jerusalem over 50 years, he wasn't the most famous king in Jewish history or the most important king in Jewish history, but he would probably rank up there with the top five. His name, anybody know his name? It was King Uzziah. King Uzziah. Now, one of the things that King Uzziah was known for was to bring the last significant spiritual revival to the people of the land. And when he died, unfortunately, he died a very disgraceful death because he violated one of the laws of God, one of his own principles of ethics. As pride became his downfall, he tried to offer incense in the temple that was completely just reserved for the priests alone. But he was in there at the altar trying to offer incense, and one of the priests confronted him and says, "Hey, what are you doing here? You know, you're not supposed to be here. This is reserved just for the priests alone." And King Uzziah began to get angry, and all of a sudden, God struck him with leprosy. And unfortunately, he had leprosy, and he lived in isolation until he died. And when he died, it sort of signaled a turning point in Jewish history, where from that day on, the spiritual life and vibrancy and vitality of the Jewish nation actually went into a tailspin. It was a huge decline which they were never able to recover from. But during this time of this struggling nation and land that was experiencing so much turmoil and mourning the loss of their king, there was a man that was being called of God to the sacred position of being a prophet. And some would believe him to be the greatest prophet that lived in the Old Testament. He was a prophet that said a virgin would conceive and bring forth a child, and his name would be called Emmanuel. He was also the prophet that said that there in the future, the servant of the Lord would come and bear the sins of the people. His name, of course, was the prophet Isaiah. Now, the prophet Isaiah had a very unique encounter with God, and this is the reason why we're using him as the example here. His encounter with God is one of the most detailed, heartfelt, emotional, glorious, amazing encounter that we can ever see in the Bible. Now, the story of this calling of this particular ministry, of this prophet, can be found in the sixth chapter of the book that bears his name. So if you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Isaiah chapter 6. We're beginning with verse 1, and it should be on the screen as well. So Isaiah 6, we'll be reading from verses 1 through 4. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each having six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory." At the sound of the voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. You know, there's a song that we used to sing years ago that was called, "I See the Lord." And it's taken exactly from this verse in Isaiah chapter 6. I'm not going to sing it for you because I want you guys to stay till the end of the service. But what I will do, I want to play a clip of the song. And while it's being played, just I want you guys to picture being there, or picture seeing this from the eyes of Isaiah, right? Being in the presence of Almighty God. Every time I sing this song, it just brings tears to my eyes because it's so emotional because of the awe and wonder and goodness of God. So let's go ahead and play that clip real quick here and just really listen to it. Such a very emotional song. I mean, if you haven't felt any emotion with that, it's really hard to hold it back. And that's just a song. Just imagine being there in the physical presence of God and experiencing him in all his glory. You know, I mean, it would blow away any of the greatest experiences that you've ever experienced here on earth and multiply that by 1,000. That's what we have to look forward to when we get to heaven. and I can't wait. Now, in this brief passage of Isaiah, I want you to notice that Isaiah states that this encounter that happened in the year that King Uzziah died, we don't know exactly whether or not if this envision took place in the temple of Jerusalem, or in fact, that what Isaiah saw was a glimpse into the true inner sanctum of heaven itself. And I'm persuaded that it's the latter interpretation, that God opened the curtain. He removed the veil from heaven itself, just as centuries later on the island of Patmos, the Apostle John would give us a glimpse, a little sneak peek of the interior of heaven. Just in the same way, Isaiah saw the Lord enthroned in heaven itself. Now, going back to Isaiah 6, verse 1, it says, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Now, if you look at the word Lord there, how is it spelled in your Bible? Is it capital L, little O, little R, little D? You see that? It's probably up on the screen, right? And then a few verses down, as the seraphim are singing, it says, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. How is that spelled up there? All caps, right? All caps. Now, this isn't a typo, right? This isn't a typographical error, but rather it's the translators that are trying to tell us that there's something going on here. They want to try to explain this text in a powerful way. Now, the fact that these two words, although it's the same English word, they're emphasized differently. They're actually different words in the Hebrew language. Now, anytime you see the word Lord in all caps, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, you can be confident that it's the word in Hebrew that means Yahweh, Y-A-H-W-E-H, the name that is revered, right, by God, the name of God that is revered and revealed to Moses on the midnight wilderness when he said, I am who I am. Okay, that's the sacred name of God, the holy name of God, Yahweh. Now, earlier, when we see the word Lord with capital L, little O, little R, little D, it translates as a completely different word in the Hebrew, which is actually the term Adonai, A-D-O-N-I. Now, this is the most exalted title of the Old Testament that they use for God, okay? It's the title given to God, and, God's been given many titles in the Old Testament, but this is the supreme title that's given to God. And I'm sorry if this sounds kind of like a college, course in Bible study, but this is really, really so important. Now, this is interesting, just how much the Jews revered God in the Old Testament, right? The original word Yahweh, okay, was originally spelled YHWH, all consonants and no vowels. And the reason for that is the Ten Commandments says not to misuse the name Yahweh, stating in Exodus 20, verse 7, that you shall not misuse the name of Yahweh your God, for Yahweh will not hold anyone who misuses his name guiltless. So in an attempt to keep from anybody breaking the Mosaic Law, or even coming close to breaking the Mosaic Law, what they said was not to speak the name of Yahweh ever. Now, that posed a problem because, as of course these Jewish leaders, right, these rabbis would teach in the synagogues, and of course Yahweh is in the scriptures like many, many times, right? So that posed a problem. What would they say when they came to the word Yahweh if they weren't allowed to say it? And they came up with a conclusion. And the answer to that was they would use the word Adonai instead. Instead of the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Yahweh, instead they would use the name Adonai, right? Capital L, little O, little R, little D. And that's how they got by that. And this is another amazing fact, another amazing reference in just how much the Jews just revered God. When the scribes would copy the scriptures onto the papyrus paper, right, when they would make copies of the scriptures. The papyrus paper basically was just the paper that they used in that day. And as they were transcribing and transferring the words over to the papyrus paper, every time they came to the word Yahweh, they would have to stop and pause. The scribe would get up out of his seat, would bathe, put on a clean set of clothes, sit back down, grab a brand new pen, and continue to proceed to write the word Yahweh and continue to translate the scriptures or transcribe the scriptures. I mean, you can imagine how long it took to write the scriptures because of the fact that every time they came to that word Yahweh, they would do the same thing. Get up out of their seat, take a shower, right? Change a set of clothes, sit back down, and then continue to write the name. So, I mean, it took a long time, not to mention how clean these scribes were, right? They're probably squeaky clean from all the showers that they've took. But getting back to our story, so you see what's happening here. The king is dead, right? There's this time of uncertainty and mourning in the land. And Isaiah comes in the name of the people. And he looks and beholds into the interior parts of heaven itself, and he sees not Uzziah, not Hezekiah, not David, but he sees Adonai, the supreme sovereign enthroned in heaven. And many people, many theologians believe that Isaiah saw the pre-incarnate glimpse of the enthronement of Jesus himself in all of his glory and majesty. Right? How glorious that must have been right at that point. But in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. I love that imagery. The train of his robe filled the temple. Now, back in the day, it was common for a victorious king, once he conquered another king, he would, of course, slay that king, and he would cut off the defeated robe's train, symbolically removing his authority to rule. And then what they would do is they would take that train that was just cut off and they would sew it onto the train of the victorious king, symbolically adding to his authority and the authority to rule that newly conquered kingdom. And Isaiah saw the Lord Yahweh, right, sitting on the throne in heaven. His robe was so lengthy that it filled the entire temple, right? He's the king of heaven, right? He is the Lord of lords, the ruler of the entire world. And Isaiah gazed at this train of God's robe. He saw all the conquests that God has ever made, train after train after train, symbolizing that God has defeated every single enemy. And we can find rest and encouragement in that our God, right, Yahweh, has defeated every enemy and any enemy that can come against us. Every trial, every tribulation, all the storms of life have all been defeated. And furthermore, right, the train is the very edge of God's garment. And it's the humblest, it's the most noble part of his clothing. But the edge of the robe itself was so glorious, right? So glorious that it filled the whole temple. And that's just his robe, the hem of his robe. How much more glorious is Yahweh himself? That's amazing. But symbolically, the robe represents God's infinite splendor and majesty, right? His glory. And one preacher explained, air is the atmosphere here on earth. Glory is the atmosphere of heaven, right? One day, we will breathe God's glory. Amen? Amen. As we continue in verse 6, in verse 2, it says, above him were the seraphim, each with six wings. Now, this is the only reference of Scripture that we have that speaks about these particular creatures called seraphim. Some try to identify them with the other angels called cherubim, but of course, I don't think that's accurate because of the fact that he distinguishes these angels specifically, separate from them, calling them seraphim. And we don't know very much about them, except for the fact that they are part of God's heavenly hosts. Right? Those that are being there, those created that were specially created by God to serve him day and night, surrounding his throne. And when we read Isaiah, this description of these odd creatures, we kind of scratch our heads and think, man, these are pretty crazy extraterrestrial beings. Of course, nothing that we've ever seen here on earth, because we're told that they had six wings. Now, what's amazing and interesting about these creatures, when God creates creatures, he does it with a certain creative economy. And by that I mean, God doesn't waste anything. He creates things in such a way that they are adaptable and suitable for their environment. Right? God makes fish with gills and fins so they can, because their natural environment is where? Is in the water. Right? He makes birds with wings and feathers because their natural environment is in the air. I mean, we don't see birds with gills or I should say fish with wings, but there is a fish with wings, right? We got the flying fish, but you know what I'm talking about. But the same is when God creates angelic beings, right, whose specific task and function in creation is to minister to God 24/7 in his immediate presence. And he created them in a way that, again, makes them fit for their environment. And God is so amazing, right? I mean, we see this creative economy over nature, all over nature, don't we? I mean, we see animals created with, you know, special nails. We look at, like, the anteater. And how he's got those long claws, right? Specifically for a reason. That's to claw at these anthills to get food, right? We look at the woodpecker. Amazing creature, right? That beak that he has, it's not just there, right? Just for nothing. But it's like a little mini jackhammer, right? To actually burrow through, you know, bark. But there's so many things of creation that we see like that. Again, these angelic beings are no different. Why not just two wings or four wings? Why six? We can find the answer as we continue to read in verse 2. He says, with two wings they cover their faces, with two they cover their feet, and with two they were flying. So God doesn't waste anything. Each pair of wings, as you see, has a specific function. And let's find out exactly the detail of what the functions are. Number one, he says, with two wings they cover their faces. Remember, the specific task and function of these angelic beings was to minister to God directly. But in the presence of God Almighty, there's no way that they can look at God and survive. And so they had to cover their eyes with their wings. Again, because of God's glory is so blindingly bright, so radiant, so piercing, that even the angels themselves have to shield their eyes from looking at God's face. Remember the story of the book of Exodus when Moses, again, who's representing the people of God, and was called by Yahweh to step into his presence because God wanted to give him the Ten Commandments, the law of God. And if you remember, Moses, as he was sending up the mountain, Mount Sinai, into the clouds, it almost seemed like he was just swallowed up in the mountain. And the people were down below waiting and waiting. They were becoming apprehensive and kind of stricken with anxiety because they wondered what happened to their leader. Was he swallowed up by the wrath of God, just like, you know, God French fried the people of Korah for their rebellion? Would he return alive? And if he did return, what was the message that he would come back with? And so they waited and waited, and they were really anxious. And while Moses was on the mountain, he spoke with God, and I believe many of us remember that conversation that he had with them. Kind of went along like this. You know, I've seen you do amazing things, some amazing things, God. You showed me the burning bush where we first met, the bush that was burning that was never consumed. I've seen the plagues that you sent down that devastated Egypt. I've seen you part the Red Sea. You even used me as an instrument to do that as I took the staff and I touched the water and the seas parted and we walked across on dry ground. I've seen you provide supernatural provisions from heaven, right? As this food from heaven fell to the ground. But God, grant me this one request. Let me see your face. Remember when we asked him? And what was God's response? Oh, Moses, you don't know what you're asking for. You know what my word says, that no man can see me and live. No, you can't see my face, but I'll tell you what, this is what I'm going to do. I'll carve out a little niche in this rock over here, and I'll put you in the cleft of the rock, and then I'll cover you, and I'll pass by and let you see my backwards parts. In the Hebrew, it says, the hind quarters of Yahweh, but my face shall not be seen. And so God put his servant in the cleft of the rock, and he allowed his servant to see him just pass by. Now, this is crazy, right? Only for a split second, Moses got a backward glance of the refracted glory of God, okay? Only for a split second. Look what happens next. When Moses was coming down the mountain and the people began to see the image of him, they saw him, they got excited, and they started running towards him. And all of a sudden, when they got close to him, they just fell flat on their faces. And they're saying, Moses, Moses, cover your face. They couldn't bear to look at him. Why? Because Moses' face was shining with such radiance and intensity that it was blinding the people. And what the people were seeing, think of it, was merely a reflection on a human being's face from a backwards, instantaneous glance of the glory of God. The angels themselves must cover their eyes in his presence. That is how holy God is, right? Blinding, his blinding presence. Let's fast forward to the New Testament for a moment for a little relevance here of God's holiness. This time speaking about the holiness of Christ for a moment. You guys know the story. The disciples have been fishing all night. They came back and their nets are empty. My wife would tell you, that sounds familiar, because every time I go fishing, my nets are empty. So the nets are empty, and Jesus approaches them, and he tells Peter, he asks Peter, hey, Peter, how did you guys do? And of course, Jesus already knew. And Peter responds, oh, it was a lousy night of fishing. We were fishing all night, and we caught nothing, got absolutely nothing. Then Jesus says, well, Peter, why don't you take the nets and cast them on the other side of the boat? And we all know Peter, right? We know Peter's profile. We know that Peter's the one that always spoke before he thought. He had the foot-shaped mouth. But can you imagine, and of course the Bible doesn't say this, but can you imagine what Peter was thinking at that particular point, right? When Jesus said, cast the nets on the other side of the boat. You can almost hear Peter saying, at least in his soul, you know, Jesus, I mean, you're a fantastic preacher. You're a fantastic theologian. An amazing religious leader. But give me some credit here. Come on, this is my job. I'm a professional fisherman, for crying out loud. You know, I've had the net over every side of this boat, and we didn't catch anything. You're going to teach me how to fish? But you're the master, and I'm only the disciple. So come on, guys, let's throw the net on the other side of the boat. And you all know the story. Every fish in the Sea of Galilee jumped in that net, right? And they even had to get another boat to help them to haul all the fish. And even these boats started to sink, right, from so much fish. Now, what does Peter do here? And this is the interesting thing. Remember, again, Peter's Jewish. And we know that Jews are phenomenal businessmen. Peter's not fishing here for fun, right? He's fishing for a living. He's fishing for profit. I mean, I know what I would have done, right? I would have reached into my tunic, pulled out a contract, and said, all right, Jesus, you know, just like Shark Tank, for 50% profit, all right, I only need 5 minutes of your time. 5 minutes, one Saturday morning, just to go out in the Sea of Galilee. You tell me to drop the nets, that's all you need to do, and I'll give you 50% of the profits. That's what I would have did, right? But that's not what Peter did. Can you believe what Peter said here? And this is amazing. Peter looked at Jesus. Peter looked at Jesus and he said, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. Peter said, Jesus, please leave me. I can't stand just being in your presence. You see, what happens is that when one who is holy comes into the midst immediately, right, comes into our midst, we immediately become uncomfortable. We become aware, dreadfully aware of our unholiness. And we want that person to get as far away from us as possible. Years ago, there was a story of a man who was the golfer of the year. And this is years ago. And part of the recognition for that award was this. That he was to play his first round of practice with Billy Graham, with the President of the United States, with Jack Nicklaus. Kind of shows you how long this has been, right? So again, this golfer, Billy Graham, Jack Nicklaus, and the President of the United States, right? That's a pretty crazy foursome, isn't it? And so they went on this course and they played this practice round. And when they got back, this golfer was asked, hey, what was it like to golf with Billy Graham and Jack and the President of the United States? And the golfer was furious. He was furious. He says, I hated it. He says, I didn't need Billy Graham to be shoving religion down my throat for 18 holes. And he stormed off and he went to the driving range and he took his iron. He just started hitting these balls, just hitting these balls and hitting these balls just to try to get rid of all this anger that was pent up in him. And so the man that asked him this question just sat there watching him hitting these balls, and as his balls diminished and he finally hit the last ball, he went up to this golfer again and he said, "Gee, Billy really came on strong, huh?" And the guy says, "No, actually, he didn't say a word about religion. I just had a bad day." The Bible says in Proverbs 28:1, "The wicked run away when no one is chasing them." Luther said, "It is the experience of the unbeliever to tremble at the rustling of a leaf." I love that. Here was a man who spent this time with Billy Graham, who's been known to be one of the meekest and gracious human beings you can ever meet. And Billy Graham didn't have to speak religion to this man. He didn't have to speak any Christianity to him. And this person was feeling very, very uncomfortable. I mean, some of you have experienced this when people find out that you're a Christian. Probably more so if you're a minister, right? Pastor Darren would attest to this. But if you're around strangers, around a crowd, and you're mingling, and everybody's having their good time, inevitably they're going to ask you the question, "What do you do?" And sometimes I'll dance around that the fact that I'm a pastor because I don't want to ruin or destroy their day, right? Because you know how people react when you tell them who you are. And pastor says it all the time when he's at the gym. When he's at the gym, he's working out, and pastor loves to mingle. He'll speak to people, and of course it'll come up, "Hey, so what do you do?" And pastor all the time, "Well, I'm a teacher," which he is, right? Or you say, "Well, I'm in the life insurance business," which he is as well, right? And again, we don't say these things, again, because we're ashamed of who we are, right? We don't want to ruin people's day. Because as soon as we tell them that we're ministers, or you tell them that you're a Christian, people start backing off, right? And they start apologizing for their language. Didn't you ever notice that? "Oh, excuse the French," right? For one thing, that wasn't French, right? But people are uncomfortable in our presence, not because we are holy, but because we represent the one who is, right? That's how powerful the holiness of God is. God, Yahweh, alone is holy. So holy that the angels need to shield their faces with their wings in his presence. Now, secondly, with two wings, they covered their feet. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us exactly and explain to us why it was necessary for the seraphim to cover their feet. We can only guess, or actually, you know, some theologians and commentators will believe that the feet of angels as well as men is the symbol in the Bible for creatureliness, if that's even a word, creatureliness. But we're told that we are of the earth and that our feet are of clay. Now, if you recall, when Moses met God in the Midianite wilderness, what was the first thing that God told him to do? He told him, "Moses, Moses, take off your shoes from thy feet," right? Because where you're standing is holy ground. God asked Moses to bare his feet, to show his feet, right, as a sign of his creatureliness, the sign of his submission before the Holy One. And so even in heaven, the angels cover the sign of their creatureliness as they are in the immediate presence of God. And then thirdly, with two they flew. Now, I don't have to get into the details of flying because you know what it means to fly or to hover in God's presence. Now, again, these are amazing creatures, no doubt about it, fascinating creatures. But it's not the physical anatomy of these creatures that's important here. So what is important? It's the message of the seraphim. It's the message of the seraphim. Listen to what the Bible tells us, right? It says in verse 3, "And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory.'" You know, there's an old hymn that many of you know, especially if you've been here, been around for a while. The name of the hymn is "Holy, Holy, Holy." I think many of you know this song. It's such a beautiful, powerful song. I truly didn't understand how powerful the song was until I began to put this sermon together. I mean, I used to sing this song back in the day, but basically I just sang it because that's what we're singing in church. But what a mistake that was. But let me just read you the lyrics to the song. "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, early in the morning my song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. I love that. All the cherubim and seraphim are falling down before thee, which wert and art and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eyes of sinful man the glory may not see, Lord, only thou art holy, and there is none besides thee. Perfect in power, in love and purity, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, you are God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Right. So, so powerful. I mean, it's hard not to have chills running up and down your spine when you sing this song because it's so magnificent. And how this song so magnificently celebrates the majesty of God. And as good as the sound when a human choir sings it, imagine this song being sung by an angelic choir. It must have been mind-blowing. But that's, in fact, exactly what Isaiah saw here. The heavenly host above the throne of God, again, singing to each other the single word over and over again, holy, holy, holy. Now, there's something here in this verse that in the English-speaking language, we can read 1,000 times and miss every single time. There's something very Jewish about this verse, in this particular text. In the English language, when we call attention to something that we see of importance, we're writing things out, what do? We can underline, we can italicize, we can boldface type it, we can put quotations or brackets around it, we can put exclamation points all over it. That's what we do in our modern day. But back in that day, they didn't have the luxury of doing that. Right? They didn't have the luxury of punctuating and italicizing and doing all those things the way we do. But what they did, what the Jews did back in that day to call attention to something that was particularly important was a simple technique of verbal repetition. That was it. Think, for example, the Apostle Paul. And when he was writing to the Galatians, and he was warning the Galatians of the danger of departing from the gospel that they had received from Paul. So in Galatians 1:8, Paul says, "But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed," or let him be damned. That's a really strong statement from the Apostle Paul, right? But get this, he doesn't stop there. He immediately goes back and says in verse 9, "As we have said..." So let me say it again. "If anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed." He says it twice, right? And that means that it's a serious, situation that he's trying to convey to them. Even Jesus himself also uses form of repetition to emphasize, again, the importance of what he was saying. Now, every word, of course, that comes out of the mouth of Jesus was important. But even the Lord took some time to call attention to specific things that he regarded as being super important. And whenever he came to a point that he wanted disciples to know that he didn't want them to forget, he would call their attention and use two words. "Truly, truly," he said, "I say to you." Or in the old translation, "Verily, verily, I say to you." Now, what he was actually saying is, "Amen. Amen," and you guys know what that word is, right? We usually say it at the end of a prayer or end of, a sermon or, in that sense. But you guys know the word as being amen, right? But Jesus, he didn't wait for the disciples to confirm the truthfulness of what he was saying. Instead, he put it in the beginning. Amen, amen, getting their attention from the beginning. Kind of like when you're on a flight, you're on an airplane, you're ready to take off, and the stewardess comes on, and she starts saying her spiel, or it's a welcome, or they're talking about the safety protocol of the vessel, or whatever it might be, and what do? You continue to do whatever you're doing, right? No real importance, right? Oh, yeah, I'm just going to put my stuff away here. I want to put my headphones on, or whatever. But when the captain jumps on, right, and he says, "Now hear this. This is your captain speaking," right? It's like, whatever you're doing, you could be in the midst of a deep sleep. You can listen to your favorite song. You can be ready to take a bite of your sandwich or peanuts or whatever it is that they give you nowadays, right? But as soon as you hear his voice and you hear those words, "Now hear this," he's got your attention. When Jesus repeated the words, saying it twice, what he was doing was he was underscoring his importance. Now listen to this. This is your captain speaking. But there's only one attribute of God that is ever raised, understand this, to the third degree of repetition. Only one. There's only one characteristic of Almighty God that is mentioned by these angels, right, that is of the highest degree. You cannot exalt anything higher than this. And the one characteristic of God is holy. But the Bible doesn't just say that God is holy here. And he doesn't just say that he's holy, holy. But he's saying that he is holy, holy, holy. Three times. One preacher said that this is the dimension of God that consumes his very essence. That's so powerful. You know, God is consumed in his holiness. And when Isaiah witnesses this amazing scene that's taking place in the heavenly realm, listen to verse 4. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Now, this is so powerful, right? These unhuman, lifeless parts of creation by God, again, these angels, in the presence of the holiness of God, had the good sense to be moved by all of this. How can we, being God's own image, being created in God's own image, not be concerned or even be apathetic, right, to his majesty? God alone is holy. You know, in closing, I know I probably didn't do God any justice by explaining how important his holiness really is. But unfortunately, with the fast-paced lives that we live today and the familiarity that we have with God, the vain repetition of praying in the morning and running out the door, or even coming here to church service, listening to a message and running out the door, it can actually inoculate us and depreciate, really water down the value of who God truly is. And we need to understand that God of the Old Testament, the God of the Bible, is the same God that we serve today. The way that we view God today, we act as if is a completely different God than the Bible and the Old Testament. You know, that he's a lesser God, definitely not Yahweh. We need to, and again, I'm preaching to myself just as much as I'm preaching to you, revere and fear God in the same way that they did in the Bible, in the Old Testament. And as we're ready to worship, as the worship team comes up here to lead us in the final song of worship, let us understand the importance of worship, especially now that we may have a little clear picture of who God is and how holy he is. We need to worship him in spirit and in truth. We need to worship him like the seraphim worshiped, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Their job and their job alone was to minister in the presence of God 24/7. But how much more for us in this brief moment that we have stepping into the presence of God, in worship, do we need to declare his holiness and honor him for who he is? You know, I didn't finish the story of Peter after Peter told Jesus to leave his presence. Of course, Jesus didn't leave. He didn't take Peter up on his invitation. Instead, he said, "Peter, come over here. Come to me with all of your burdens and your cares and your problems, and I will give you rest. I will give you peace." This invitation by Jesus to Peter is probably the best kept secret in the world. That we, all of humanity, are invited to come into his presence, the Holy One of God, to bear it all before him, to be naked before him in his presence. Maybe you're listening to all of this stuff about holiness and recognize that you are unholy. You've never understood or paid attention to religion, let alone the holiness of God. Let me just say one thing, that Jesus welcomes you with open arms. He will give you peace and give you access to God's holy presence. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, that you are holy. Thank you, Father, that you are holy in an unholy universe. And again, not just holy or holy, holy, but you are holy, holy, holy. Lord, give us the hearts of the seraphim for that truth. And may we revere you. May we exalt you. May we praise you. May we honor you for who you are. Lord, forgive us for not revering you the way you should be revered. The way that we see you being revered in the Bible. I'm ashamed at myself for not doing so. And Father, allow this day moving forward for all of us to understand just how holy you are. So thank you, Lord God, for your people. I ask, Lord, for your holy anointing upon them as they go about their business, just to remember who you are, the creator of the universe, that you even find time to look at us and call us your children. Thank you, God, for all that you've done and continue to do in each and every one of our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Let's all stand.